Dear students, today we will discuss about some more programs, some practical programs related to the two-dimensional arrays. Already we have discussed about the basic structure of two-dimensional arrays, the declaration, initialization, the storage, memory allocation, then some programs. Some basic programs related to the manipulation of elements present inside a two-dimensional arrays. Now today we will see few more programs, few more practical or application-oriented programs where we are applying the concept of two-dimensional arrays. So the first program we are going to discuss is to find the sum or to add the content of two matrices. So this is our first program that is to be discussed today. Now let us see the summation. What is the basic logic behind the summation of two matrices? So assume that we are having a matrix A here with elements like 1, 2, 3 4. I am having another matrix here B with elements. I will provide the same values again here 1, 2, 3, 4. So I have given two matrices. First matrix A is of 2 by 2 order. Similarly, the second matrix B is also of 2 by 2 order. Two rows and two columns here. Here also we are having two rows and two columns. Now, what is the basic condition? What condition must be satisfied when we deal with the addition of two-dimensional arrays? The condition is the number of rows of first matrix must be exactly equivalent to the number of rows present in the second matrix. And in the same time, the number of columns present in the first matrix must be equivalent to the number of columns present in the second matrix also. Okay. If there is any violation of these two rules, that means if the rows are not equal or if the columns are not equal, if any condition fails, we cannot proceed with the addition of two matrices. So, before moving into the logic of addition, we need to have this size checking. So we need to be very careful while reading the matrix values. But before that, unknowingly, if you are reading two different size, two different columns or two different row matrices, so we need to have some solution for, because we cannot further proceed with the matrix addition. So that situation, what we are doing is we will just stop from there and we will not proceed with matrix addition. Now we will see that how we can implement these two. Now the number of rows and columns are equal if for these two matrices they will be adding, like the corresponding locations will be added for both the matrices. 0th row, 0th column of first matrix will be added with 0th row and 0th column of second matrix. 0th row, first column of first matrix will be added with 0th row, first column of second matrix. Similarly, this one and this one and this one. Finally, we will be getting a third matrix. It can be called as a matrix C, for example. We will be getting like 2, 4, 6 and 8. Matrix A plus matrix B is equivalent to matrix C with these values. So this is the traditional matrix addition operation. Now how this can be implemented by using C language, we will see in detail. Now just look at the program. Now here we are having standard IO dot h, std IO dot h for getting all the input output operations related to the program. Now along with that, I am using one more library function, std lib dot h, which consists of a predefined function that is called as exit. As I said, if this condition, any of these condition fails, we need to exit from the program. We cannot even continue with any more statements within that particular, because we cannot do matrix. So that was our aim. So we cannot do matrix addition over there. So we need to exit from the program. So just for getting this exit function, we are using this std lib, because this is stored inside this std lib dot h header file. Okay. Now within the main, just look at the declaration statement. Just look at the declaration statements. R1 indicates the row size of first matrix, then C1 the column size of first matrix, R2 row size of second matrix, C2 is column size of second matrix. So we are reading two matrix, so both rows as well as columns we need to read. Now this is the declaration of first matrix A of 2020, we are giving maximum size. This is the second matrix B of 2020. Then we are having the third matrix where we are going to store the result, that is C of 2020. So A will be added with B and the result will be stored inside the matrix C. Then we are having one I variable for the matrix outer loop, that is for rows, and J is for the inner loop, that is for columns, as usual. Now enter the order of matrix. We need to read the exact order, that means the rows and columns of both matrices. So we will read all these together, or else we can do it separately also. Now here in this case we are reading all these values together, four integer values, ampersand R1, C1, R2, C2, first matrix row column, second matrix row and column. Just after reading this, we are just going for checking a condition. If R1 is not equal to R2, if R1 is not equal to R2 means the number of rows in matrix A is not equal to the number of rows in matrix B, or if the number of columns present in matrix A is not equal to the number of columns present in second matrix. If any one of these condition violates, we will just print the addition is not possible. Just print that statement and give the method exit that was there in the predefined or the header file stdlib.h. It will automatically exit from the entire program. It will exit out of the program. So that is why we are using exit, because we don't need to execute all these following statements, because we cannot even do, we are not at all trying to read the matrix also. If the orders are not matching, we are not even trying to read the matrix or printing the matrix, or even we are not going to do any operation on those two matrices. Now let us see what are the other operations. So one condition is being checked, that is whether the number of rows and columns of both matrices are equal or not. If anyone violates, we will exit from the program. If it is not, if both are matching means we can continue with the remaining portion of the program. Okay, so first thing is we need to read two matrices. Okay, so now let us see how we can read these two matrices. So just look at these two statements. This is matrix A, enter the matrix A, just like normal reading. For I equal to 0 to R1 less than R1, that is the row size. J equal to 0 to column size, enter the element. So here we are using a different pattern just for displaying A of 00, A of 01, A of 10, A of 11. Just printing that, then we are scanning A of ij. So first case 0 0 will be printed here. Then next iteration 0 1 will be printed. Next iteration it will exit. Then for I equal to 1, then again j equal to 0 will read a of 1 0, then a of 1 1. So these four values will be scanned. Then the second matrix. So first matrix is ready. Second matrix, enter the matrix B, similar loop, less than R2, less than C2, enter the element B of %D %D. So this format we are going to display, scan of Bij. We'll read B00, B01, B10, B11, if the size was 2 by 2. I am mentioning about size 2 by 2. So that matrix is also ready. Now already the condition is being verified before entering the matrix itself, so we can directly move towards the addition of two matrices. So just look at the final loop where we are going to find out the sum of two matrices. So the added matrix C, we are going to directly add and print that third matrix. Okay, now just look at this. We are having an outer loop for I equal to 0, I less than R1. You can take here R2 and here you can take C2. Both are same because either we can use R1 or R2 here, or we can use C1 or C2 here, any one, because both sizes are same. So for I equal to 0, I less than R1, I plus plus. For J equal to 0, J less than C1. So up to the number of rows and columns, C of ij is equal to, C of ij is equal to, just listen, I equal to 0, J equal to 0, C of 0 0 is equal to, C of 0 0 is this one, is equal to A of ij, A of 0 0 plus B of ij, B of 0 0. So this is A of 0 0 and this is B of 0 0. These two will be added to form C of ij value. One value will be printed. Now next inner loop iteration, j is equal to 1. C of ij, C of I is already 0, C of 0 1, C of 0 1, for this location A of ij, A of 0 1, A of 0 1, this one will be added with B of 0 1. We are getting C of 0 1. Then j equal to again one more increment, condition fails, it will come out. Then just print a slash n. Here we will be printing a slash n because after printing 2 and 4, next line we need to print other two values just for forming that matrix format. Okay, so now again the outer loop, next iteration I will become 1, I less than R1, that is true. Then again inside that inner loop, again starting with J equal to 0, now 1 0, C of 1 0, this location is equal to A of 1 0, this one, plus B of 1 0, that is this one. 3 plus 3 will be added, C of 1 0 value will be filled. Next iteration J become 1, so I is already 1, C of 1 1, this location is equal to A of 1 1 plus B of 1 1. This 4 plus 4 8 will be placed in C of 1 1. Then again put a slash in and then we'll go out of the, so next iteration again I increment, this condition fails and it will come out of the loop. So 2 4 6 8 matrix will be printed in this particular format. So this is the addition of two matrices. So the number of rows and the number of columns of both matrices must be equal for providing a matrix addition program. Okay, so just I will show you the result, how it will be displayed in this while executing that in our C compiler to be like, enter the order of matrix, enter the order of matrix 2 2 2 2. I am giving 2 row 2 column for first matrix, 2 row and 2 column for second matrix. I am directly getting the value. If you wish, you can get it separately also. Enter the order of first matrix, then enter the order of second matrix. That way also we can read the values, but here I am reading that together. Now enter the matrix A, enter the element A of 0 0. I will be scanning A of ij 1, next iteration 2. I am giving 4 different values, that is the matrix will be like 1 2 3 4. This is the first matrix. Now matrix B 5 6 7 8, so this is the second matrix. So this is A and this is B. Now the added matrix 5 plus 1 6, then 6 plus 2 8, 7 plus 3 10, then 8 plus 4 12. This is the sample output of the above program. Hope it is clear. The addition of two matrices, looking at the condition, and similar type of matrices can be added. Okay, now we will move to another program, that is the matrix multiplication. That is one of the major implementation or program that is very popular in two-dimensional arrays. So let us see how this matrix multiplication happens usually with any matrix. Similar to the previous case, here also we require two matrices to be multiplied. Assume that we are having the first matrix. I am taking a simple matrix only, first matrix with 2 rows and 3 columns. First matrix with 2 rows and 3 columns. This is the matrix A. Then I am giving another matrix, that is the matrix B. There we are having 3 rows and 3 columns. This is the matrix B. So you can see in the case of addition, both are having same number of rows and columns, but here it is not like that. You can see the matrix A is of 2 by 3. This is of order 2 by 3. And we can see the matrix B is of type or size or order, that is 3 by 3. Now the condition. Now the condition for checking whether the multiplication is possible or not. So this is 3 by 3. As I need to add the resultant matrix here, that is why I have removed that. So the result matrix will be, can be called as C, with these number of rows and columns. Now look at two statements. This is the number of rows for matrix A. This is the number of columns for matrix A. This is the number of rows for matrix B. The number of columns for matrix B. So the multiplication possibility, we need to check for a major condition. That means the number of columns in the first matrix, that is this one, must be equivalent to the number of rows present in the second matrix. That is the condition to be satisfied while doing matrix multiplication. The number of columns in the first matrix must be equivalent to the number of rows in the second matrix. is 3, number of columns is 3, number of rows here is 3. We don't consider other two points, whatever it be, but for multiplication, the second, that means the number of columns of first two row, C1 must be equivalent to R2, that is the number of rows present in the second matrix. That is the basic condition. If that is false, we cannot continue with matrix multiplication. Just like addition, if that condition fails, we are exiting from the program. We cannot further go for any multiplication operation. So that is the first point. Now second thing is regarding the result. So columns and rows are now equivalent. Now what about the resultant or the result of these two matrix multiplication will be having? Just listen here. The result C must have the same number of rows as in the first matrix. The same number of rows. A, we are having two rows. The result must also consist of two rows. It will automatically come. Similarly, the number of columns in second matrix, that is here it is 3, that same number of columns must be there in the resultant matrix also. The number of rows of first matrix must be there in the resultant matrix also. The number of columns of the second matrix must be there in the resultant matrix also. Okay, so these are the basic conditions related to the two different matrix being, or when we are going for multiplication of two different matrices. Okay, now the basic idea is clear. Now when we all are very familiar with matrix multiplication, that we have already done with our mathematics, right? So what we are actually doing with this matrix multiplication, assume that if you are having, I will give some value here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, this is the first matrix, I will give here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Assume that these are two matrices. Condition satisfies this one and this one is equal. Now how this multiplication happens? This is the resultant matrix. We have to fill a value here. Then we have to fill a value here. Then we have to fill a value here, 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 and here. Now what is the logic behind the matrix multiplication? So after understanding these concepts, the program can be easily understandable. So just take the first row, I mean the zeroth row of first matrix will be processed with the zeroth column. Just remember, zeroth row of matrix A will be processed with zeroth column of second matrix. Now what processing we are going to do? So just imagine here we use I loop for ith row, then for second it is being processed with zeroth column. Now this is considered as J. So one outer I loop is for taking the row, then we are having one J loop is for taking the column inner. Okay, so after finishing this first row, so first row will be processed with, I mean zeroth row will be processed with zeroth column, then zeroth row will be processed with first column of second matrix, then zeroth column will, I mean zeroth row will be processed with the second column of second matrix. Okay, so outer loop I for 0, J 0 to n minus 1. Okay, less than C1, that means the number of, I mean C2, that depends on the number of columns. Now, what process will be happening between these two? So, this row and this column, what is to be done? So, what we are going to do is, now we need to have a third loop. When we come to the logic, we need to have a third loop. What we are doing is, this 0th row, 0th column, this value will be multiplied with this value. This will be multiplied with this value. These two will be multiplied with, I mean, these will be multiplied. Then that will be added with the multiplication of these two. And that will be added with the multiplication of these two. So 0, 0 will be multiplied with 0, 0 plus 0, 1 will be multiplied with 1, 0 plus 0, 2 will be multiplied with 2, 0. And all these will be added to form this value. So for 0th row, we are processing the 0th column. We are getting a value. Multiply these two, add that with the result of these two multiplication, and add that to the multiplication of these two values. We are getting a value here. Now, this is the outermost loop, I. We are with the same row. 0 will remain the same. Now, j will be incremented. It will move to 0 to 1 here. Now, this value will be multiplied with this one. Plus, this value will be multiplied with this one. Plus, this value will be multiplied with this one, and add those three will get the value over here. Then again increment j once again. 0 remains the same. Increment j once again. This value will be multiplied with this one, plus this will be multiplied with this one, plus this will be multiplied with this one. Will be getting this position value. Again j, one more time increment, condition fails, it will go to the outer loop. Now I will be incremented to 1. Okay, now first row will be going for processing the different columns to get these values. So, first row, first value, 1, 0 will be multiplied with this one, this will be multiplied with this one, this will be multiplied with this one, and these three will be added to form this value. Okay, now similarly, the same first row, this value will be multiplied with this one, this will be multiplied with this one, this will be multiplied with this one, you will get this value. Similarly, this also, and this will be the result of the matrix multiplication. Just look at the size of this, the resultant matrix, the product, we can call it as cross product, third matrix consists of the cross product. Okay, so it will be having the same number of rows as in the first matrix, and it will be having the same number of columns as in the second matrix. So the logic is, for each row of the first matrix, first row crosses with all the columns, fill the corresponding cells of the third matrix. Then first row or next row crosses with all the columns j values, fill these cells. We are getting the result of multiplication. That means matrix A into matrix B will get matrix C. So this is the logic for finding the product or multiplication of two different matrices. I think the idea is clear. Now let us see the logic in our program. Okay, now you can easily understand the logic. We are directly applying all these concepts in our program. I hope it will be very clear. This idea is already familiar, because in your mathematics you might have gone through writing two matrix, and you are finding this multiplication by getting the cross product. This one into this one, plus this one into this one, plus this one into this one, next one into this one. So accordingly, the same thing. This is the first matrix, this is the second matrix. Exactly the same thing. Just for getting this idea, I am writing in this format. Otherwise, in your mathematics, you are directly writing two matrix and you are following the same thing. Now, just for understanding these concepts easily, I am drawing this in this format, so that we can understand what is required for our multiplication, like number of rows and number of columns, the number of columns of matrix A and the number of rows in the matrix 2, that comparison, and what is the size of the resultant matrix. All these things are available in this particular example. Now let us look at the program. stdio.h, then lib. Here also, if the condition fails, we need to exit from the program. So we are taking the exit function from stdlib.h. Now inside the main, we are going for declaration: row 1, column 1, row 2, column 2. Then this is the first matrix, second matrix, third matrix. Then I is for this first matrix, first row, then second row, that is I. J is for second matrix, 0 to the last column. Then K is for doing this multiplication and addition. For that process, we are using an inner K loop. So K is actually used for finding this exact cross product. Okay, so I is for taking each row from matrix A, J is for taking each column along with I, and K is for finding the cross product, the third inner operation. That is exact operation required for matrix multiplication. Then enter the order of matrix. We'll read row 1, column 1, row 2, column 2. Now we are simply checking the number of column, the number of columns C1, the number of columns of first matrix is not equal to number of rows of second matrix. If that is not equal, it will print like multiplication is not possible and it will exit from the program. Okay, that will be very clear. Previous case addition, what was the condition? You just imagine. Here the condition is different. That is normal matrix multiplication, common condition. So if that fails means if they are not equal. If they are not equal, we cannot continue with matrix multiplication. Okay, now assume that it is equal. In our example also, it is equal. So we can go for further manipulation or processing of matrix multiplication. Okay, so we need to read similar to the previous case, we need to read all the sizes are already available now. Now we need to go for reading the two matrices that is to be multiplied. That is our next step. That is enter the matrix A. Enter the matrix A. Enter the matrix A for I equal to 0 to R1, J equal to 0 to C1, enter element A of 0, 0, A of 0, 1, 1, 0, that way up to row 1 and column 1, scan the first matrix, this one, scan the first matrix. Similarly, so the loop, all these things are clear. Now, second matrix B, the same thing, I 0 to R2, J 0 to C2, read the elements of second matrix. Here we can use a different order, but R1 and C2 must be, sorry, C1 and R2 must be equal. That is already being verified. Okay, now after reading these two matrix, we'll just try to print the third matrix. That is, so while printing the third matrix itself, we'll apply the logic. So just look at the remaining program, the major portion of the matrix multiplication. Now, as I said before, while applying this logic, we are using three loops. First loop is for getting the rows of first matrix. Then second loop is for getting the columns of second matrix. And third loop is for cross product execution. Okay, so now let us see, for I equal to 0, I less than equal to R1 row, so I is dealing with the number of rows present in the first matrix. So I equal to 0, then next iteration I will be 1, next iteration it will be terminating. Okay, now first of all, for 0th row it will enter into the next loop. For J equal to 0, J less than C2, second matrix number of columns. So this is for taking all these columns. So first of all, 0th column, then next iteration, first column, next iteration, second column, then next iteration, it will be exiting. While doing that exit, from here when we are exiting, the next I row will be incremented. So first of all, 0th row, I need to process all the j's 0 to n minus 1. Then when it exits from that loop, increment I to 1. Then for this row, again go to j from 0 to n minus 1. We need to do the same process. I think these two, it is clear. These two things are clear. Now inside that inner j loop, now we are setting a value C of ij is equal to 0. C of ij is equal to 0. Because in the previous addition, we are not assigning such 0 value because we are directly adding two values and we are storing that. But here you already know that after doing this multiplication, this one and this one, that is to be stored in C of ij first. Then again find this one and this one, multiply these two, then add these two and store it in C of ij. So we are actually accumulating, just like sum, we are accumulating the value here. So that is why we are initializing the value C of ij is equal to 0. Otherwise initially it will be having some garbage value, so there may be a wrong result that may produce due to this garbage value. Okay, now first row, 0th row, 0th row, then zeroth column. Here we are. Zeroth row, zeroth column. We are. C of ij equal to 0. This is assigned as 0 now initially. Now we are applying the loop for cross product. You have to listen very carefully. For k equal to 0. For k equal to 0. K is equal to 0. K less than C1. C1 is number of column. Up to the number of columns available in the first matrix, we are continuing this multiplication and addition. Multiply and add. Right? So 0th row, 1, 2, 3. 3 times. That is depends on number of columns. We are doing multiplication and addition. Okay, so that is why k less than c1, because that is depending on the number of columns present in the first matrix. Then k plus plus. So k is the loop used for only this cross product, multiply and add. Now here inside this c of ij is equal to, now we are going to accumulate. Initially it was 0, now we are going to accumulate c is equal to, I mean c of ij plus c equal to, because first it is 0, then this value into this value, that must be added, new c of ij. Next, this value into this one, that is to be accumulated, add once again, store that. Then again, this value must be multiplied with this one, that is also to be added with the previous c of ij. That is why it is given as c of ij plus c equal to. That means c of ij is equal to c of ij plus, that is actually plus c equal to. Okay, now this is a type of assignment operator, I think you are familiar. So c of ij plus c equal to, now look at this statement. This is the major portion where we are actually doing cross product. Now k is equal to 0, right? Now a of ik, look at this multiplication, a of ik. What is I now? 0. What is k now? 0. A of 0, 0. This one, A of 0, 0 will be multiplied with B of second matrix, k. What is the value of k? 0. What is the value of j? 0. B of 0, 0. These two will be multiplied and that will be added with 0. C of ij is 0. And that is assigned to C of ij now. So 0 plus this multiplication value will be the value of C of ij now. It is not over. Then that is one multiplication is over. Then go for next iteration. That is k is equal to 1. K is equal to 1. K is equal to 1. What will happen? C of ij again is equal to a of ik. I is 0, k is 1. 0, 1. This one will be multiplied with b of k. K is 1, j is 0. Right? B of 1, 0. That means this is 1 and this is 0. These two will be multiplied. Okay, that is accumulated to C of ij. Now we'll be having a new C of ij value here. Again go for next iteration. Next iteration, k is equal to 2. K is equal to 2. Now A of ik, A of 0, 2. 0, 0, 2. This is 0, 1, 2. This is 0, 2. Will be multiplied with B of second matrix, k is 2 now, j is 0, 2, 0, this is 2, 2, 0, this one. These two will be multiplied and that will be accumulated to C of ij. We are getting a final value of C of ij here. Why it is final? Because when it goes for one more k, k is equal to 3, 3 less than 3, that is a failure. It will exit from this loop. loop. Okay, it will print C of ij. It will print C of ij. So temporarily it is storing this value. Then finally, when we are printing, we are actually displaying that value in our screen. We are printing this value. Then it will go for next iteration of j. Now I remains zero itself. Now j will be incremented by 1. J will be incremented by 1. It will go here. Again, c of ij equal to 0. Now what is ij? C of 0, 1. C of 0, 1. This portion, it will become 0. For k equal to 0, it will start from 0 itself. K equal to 0, k less than c1, the same thing. K plus plus, c of ij plus c equal to this one. A of ik, A of ik, what is A of ik? A of I is 0, k is 0, this one will be multiplied with B of k is 0, j is 1, B 0, 1, B 0, 1, that is this value. Multiply these two. Similarly, repeating the step, this value will be multiplied with this one, this value will be multiplied with this one, add, then we are getting new C of ij. Again exit, j again incremented by 1, it will become 2, the same 0, again still I remains the same 0, the same row will be processed with these 3 also. This will be multiplied with 3, this will be multiplied with 6, this will be multiplied with 9, we are getting this value. Then again j will be incremented, condition fails, it will go out and continue with next iteration. Here we are putting a slash in for new line because next row to be printed in the next line. Go for next iteration of I. I is equal to 1. It will come to this row. So the same steps will be repeated, like for this row, this column will find this value. For this row, this column will find this value. For this row, this column will find this value. Then again, I will be incremented. It is a failure, less than R1 fails, it will exit from the program. So this is the procedure that we are following in a matrix multiplication program. The basic idea is very clear. The number of columns in the first matrix must be equivalent to the number of rows in the second matrix, then only the matrix multiplication is possible. Now just remember about three loops. First row of matrix, don't say first row, zeroth row of matrix A, first matrix will be processed with all the columns of the second matrix, and corresponding resultant matrix will be filled. What is this processing? Cross product. Each location by location, so row, zeroth row, zeroth column. Multiply each element and add to get this particular value. Similarly, this row will be processed with all the column, the next row will be processed with all the column, and all the value will get filled. So that is the procedure used for matrix multiplication. Hope the idea is clear. First of all, you should know what is matrix multiplication, how it is actually working, and second thing is you need to remember how it is executed or how it is being written by using the language C. Now just look at the result of the same program. See, enter the order of matrix. Here in this example I am using 2 2 2 2 2 by 2 matrix. Matrix A, we are having 4 values, 1 2 3 4, 1 2 3 4, Then matrix 2 we are having 5, 6, 7, 8. Then after doing the multiplication of these two matrix, after applying those logic, we will be getting the values like 12, 22, 43 and 50. Now the size 2 by 2, 2 by 2. So column of first is equivalent to row of second. Multiplication is possible and we are getting the same sized matrix as the result. So this is a very, very important problem and a program related to the two-dimensional array. Now we will discuss one more point slightly, that is regarding the multi-dimensional arrays. Just we will see what is a multi-dimensional array. We are not going to see in detail about programs and all. So array means a single dimension, a single row starting from 0 to n minus 1, 0, 1, 2, for example. This is an array A. Now matrix A means we'll be having two dimensions, like number of rows and number of columns, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2. Now what is a three-dimensional array? 3D is an example for a multi-dimensional array. 4D, 5D, all these things are available, but even 3D itself is complex. But just understand what is this 3D. Now array of arrays. Array, this is array. This is array of arrays. That is matrix or 2D array. Now an array of 2D array can be called as a 3D array. Now what is that? For example, we are having a matrix like this one. We are having another matrix like this one. Now this will be considered as 0, 0th matrix, first matrix. Now for 0th matrix, 0th row, first row, second row. For 0th matrix, 0th column, first column, second column. For first matrix, 0th row, first row, second row. For first matrix, 0th column, first column, second column. Now this can be represented as a 3D array, because now this is the expansion: single array, 2D array, 3D array. Array of arrays. When we form different arrays together, we are getting matrix. When we are forming or combining different matrices together or different 2D arrays together, we are getting 3D arrays. Now this can be represented like, if A is the name of the 3D, it can be represented like A of 2 of 3 of 3. This is the representation of a 3D array. Now what is this 2? This 2, 2 matrices index. This entire matrix you are having an index. This entire matrix you are having another index. So that is this one. So totally, this means totally you are having two-dimensional arrays available. The next one, on each of these, you are having three number of rows and three number of columns. So just for understanding I am giving this multi-dimensional concept. It's a difficult task to write all the loopings, because you can imagine again with matrix you are having two levels, and if you are having some processing you are having three levels. Now for this three dimension you will be having one more higher level. I will be for this different matrix indexes, then J will be for rows, then K will be for columns, etc., etc. So just understand this 3D concept and what are the meanings of the three dimensions present in this particular three dimensional array. So that is enough for understanding the basics of 3D array. Or similarly, you will be having more dimensions are also possible. So that is not required now for current purpose. So that's it for now. So today's sessions we have seen some major application, some major programs related to the two dimensional arrays, like addition of two arrays and multiplication of two arrays, the conditions and the iterations and the actual happenings, the actual addition or multiplication process and the logic of those programs, and also a slight introduction to the 3D, three-dimensional arrays also. So that's it for now. Hope it is clear, almost clear with two-dimensional arrays with enough number of programs. In the next session, we will see another array, another set of arrays that is called as character arrays and its processing and other operations. Character arrays are usually called as strings. So how to handle strings in C programming will be discussed in the next session. Thank you.